Yes.
The students have worked very hard on this conference. We're so excited. It's here. We love the tradition of having a student-run conference. And this year's conference leaders are Lillian Alvernaz and Emily Slade. And I am Professor Michelle Bryan. I teach natural resource courses here, and I supervise with Professor Monty Mills, the fabulous Monty Mills, the Law Review. So this evening we have the distinct pleasure of kicking things off with a keynote address by Daniel Giorgiani. And we're privileged to introduce him. We apologize. There was flight delays today because of the weather this morning. So Daniel Giorgiani currently serves as the acting solicitor and principal deputy solicitor. I'm going to read these things because there's some wrong of the U.S. Department of the Interior. He is a veteran of the Department of Interior who formerly served as counselor to the deputy secretary, and there will be a quiz after, and counselor and chief of staff to the assistant secretary for policy management and budget in the George W. Bush administration. So he has a long view on some of these issues. He's been at it for a while. He also has over two decades of corporate, nonprofit, and legal experience. He received his undergraduate degree from Vanderbilt University, his master's degree from Columbia University, and his Juris Doctor from Cornell Law. He is a member of the New York and District of Columbia Bars, and he tells me that he welcomes questions throughout his talk this evening. Isn't that awesome? So thank you, Daniel, for joining us.
First, I'd like to say thank you for having me here today. Can folks in the back hear me? I was told not to use a mic. Good. Thank you to the university, to the law school, for organizing such a superb event. It was really exceptional. I do want to apologize. I'm not sure if I picked it up from my 10-year-old, my 8-year-old, or a 6-year-old. But I'm either nursing a bad flu or a very bad head cold right now. So I welcome questions throughout. I want to keep this as informal as possible. First and above all, I'd like to thank President Trump for the Trump administration. I'd like to thank Secretary Zinke for the honor to serve in this administration. Regulatory reform at the U.S. Department of the Interior. It's been a challenge. It's been a challenge for us. But why are we doing it? Does anybody wonder why regulatory reform is important? Usually somebody will ask a question. Now for us, true or not, because there's an ongoing debate between economists on what the actual impact of overregulation is on the U.S. economy. But for us, it is one of our key sort of principles that the U.S. economy has been overregulated. Question? Yep. And so, one of the very first things the Secretary did established the Regulatory Reform Task Force, which is chaired by David Bernhardt, the Deputy Secretary of the U.S. Interior. We have assistant secretaries and head of all the bureaus as part of the Regulatory Reform Task Force. The first thing we did was cut the number of upcoming regulations by 50%, from 270 down to 133, those that were most important to advancing the Secretary's mission. What is the Secretary's mission? Has anybody here heard of Ryan Zinke before? I thought so. Based on what you've heard about the Secretary, what do you think his top priorities are? Back there?
Compliance, economic development, and resources.
Compliant and consistent with all existing environmental laws, but yes. Economic development. What else have you heard about Secretary Zinke's priorities? He would like to move troops to the front lines. He thinks we have too many people in Washington, D.C. Too too much authority in Washington, D.C., and would like more authority shifted out into what he calls the field. Anything else? Well, I'll get you the third one, is rebuilding trust inside the United States Department of the Interior. Trust within the department, and trust between the department and stakeholders. Whether that's the tribes. Oh, yes, please, ma'am.
What has led him to believe there's a lack of trust?
Oh, yes. First, very good question. Somebody has asked, what led him to believe that there's a lack of trust within the department? Within or between the department and stakeholders? In the department, actually in every federal agency, you have something called the Office of the Inspector General. And the Office of the Inspector General over the past 8 years issued report after report after report. Ethical violations, sexual harassment violations, senior employees abusing junior employees, issues of abuse in the tribes, and BIE schools, both university and secondary schools. So it was based on these 8 years of reports from the IG that led him to focus on this type of case. Follow up?
Well, I'm just curious. I mean, I think those are worthy things we need to work on, but I don't see how that particular area of loss of trust has to do with the mission of the economic impact and the overregulation.
Oh, no. Very good question. Three separate components. Well, IN Secretary's priority is trust, building out the trust. Returning authority to the field and personnel to the field. Oh, yes.
I have a question. So is there any concern with moving more, empowering the field in terms of regulation being interpreted and implemented differently across the state? Are you a little concerned about that?
That's an incredibly good question. Because when you look at regulation on a federal level, there's very little ground, very little nuance given state level interpretation. So when we're talking about regulatory reform, let's take two or three recent examples of regulatory reform. And it is incredible the amount of regulations that are produced throughout the United States Department of the Interior on an annual basis. From our relations with the tribes, Indian Trader Rights, from Endangered Species Act, National Park Service, energy development onshore and offshore. So when you're talking about the regs, when we're talking about moving folks out to the field, already out to the field, it is, frankly, it's a management, it's an intriguing component of management, one we're still working on, frankly. Follow up? Oh, that was a very good question. I'm sorry, ma'am, I don't know if I answered your question.
Okay, that's fine.
All right, so regulatory reform. The Regulatory Reform Task Force meets once per month. Representatives of all the assistant secretaries, all the bureau directors, on the Regulatory Reform Task Force, I'm the policy director. When you look at some of the regulations that we've addressed so far, I think the ones that have garnered the most press, both in policy journals and in litigation, you'll see the honor evaluation rule, hydraulic fracking rule, venting and flaring, have all three garnered press recently. Those are considered within the regulatory framework of Washington, D.C. have been relatively successful attempts at reforming specific regulations within the U.S. Department of Interior. That's a very good question. That's a very good question. For any project, you have to determine what is success. So when you look at a rule, you go through notice and comment, whether it's traditional notice and comment. One measure is, do you get the rule through OIRA, through OMB, is it published in the Federal Register? And ideally, before a rule is even conceived, do you know what the rule wants to accomplish? When you're rescinding a rule, the metric is very simple. You've actually formally rescinded the rule. Good. All right. So continuing, why are we focused on regulation? Is the U.S. actually overregulated? Are the responsibilities of the U.S. Department of the Interior, where we have actual responsibilities? Sovereign to sovereign of the tribes, endangered species regulation, regulation of the national parks. what is it we choose to regulate and deregulate? Now, you don't have to fully subscribe to theories of corporate capture, of public interest theory, of so many variations on it, you know, which economists that you read. Our general view, though, is the more regulation that you have, the less likely it is that those who are not connected, those who do not have DC lawyers, large trade associations, advocating on their behalf, the less likely they are to be effective getting their interests heard. Some call this cronyism, some call it corporate welfare. There's one thing that I think President Trump and certainly Secretary Zinke has focused on, is trying to unrig the system. And when we see a lot of these regulations, venting and flaring, hydraulic fracking, others, it's clear from the moment of conception that they're designed to advance a certain agenda. For us, we do believe elections have consequences. Like or dislike the Trump administration, elections have consequences. It is highly likely, whenever another administration comes into power, they can overturn our regulations as well. Regulations are at best a temporary fix. I don't know if you had another question.
Sorry.
Is there, okay. So, oh, please.
What, I just didn't ask your thoughts. So as soon as I talk about Japan, as the regulations change underneath different administrations, what effect does that have as sort of back and forth kind of flip side that takes place on the regulated party?
Wow, incredibly good question. The question is, what does this lack of certainty in the regulatory process do to stakeholders? Whether you're an environmental group, an industry group, or just a mom and pop operation working somewhere on lands regulated by the Department of Interior. It has a negative impact. Regulatory uncertainty has a negative impact. Which is why, whatever the administration is, you want to be very careful in choosing which regulations you seek to address. Because there are literally thousands of regulations that clear through all of IRA on an annual basis. Which ones are the ones that can most advance any administration's agenda? It doesn't matter whether you're Cass Sunstein, Naomi Rao, Bill Hamburger, wherever you are on the economic study spectrum when it comes to regulation. The regulatory, lack of regulatory certainty is a major ongoing issue. Yes, sir.
So what's the benefit of rolling back monuments and permitting activities that would degrade the character, natural character of the monument for which it was created?
Is there a monument review process going on? I think I've heard.
As it goes.
Yes.
What's the benefit of rolling back a monument?
You know, that's intriguing. I myself am not directly involved in the monument process. I view that as separate and apart from the regulatory reform construct. But I think there is an ongoing process. And I think there are reports underway right now. But at the end of the day, I think it's really the president's decision, whichever president, to decide within the constraints of the Antiquities Act, to decide how they want to approach this issue. But I'm viewing that issue as separate and apart from what I'm here to. But it's a good question.
So follow up then.
Sure.
What's the benefit of rolling back regulation if you don't consider economic benefits of clean air and clean water, worker safety, wildlife habitat? Are these values considered in the benefit of rolling back?
You should never undertake a regulation, whether you're in a Democratic administration or Republican administration, without doing a significant cost-benefit analysis. And when you look at the cost-benefit analysis that was done for the previous administration, venting and flaring, hydraulic fracking, there is rigorous cost-benefit analysis. Everybody brings in their own economists, but at the end of the day, these are often policy decisions on which to prioritize or not to prioritize. I was going to continue, but go ahead, sir.
Is there a relationship between over-regulation and selective enforcement? And does one lead to the other? And if you roll back regulations, can you do something about selective enforcement?
That's an incredibly good point. Incredibly good point. You can look at something such as the Migratory Bird Treaty Act and the M opinion associated with where there's tremendous amounts of prosecutorial discretion over who and prosecutors go after and who they don't go after. And this is a key concern about overregulation, essentially, where you criminalize everything. That's tremendous power in the hands of main justice, hands of local U.S. attorneys, over what laws to enforce and what laws not to enforce. That's not a particularly radical statement. That's just both parties, both sides of the regulatory debate agree on this. You're regulating everything, and particularly when you have unclear criminal sanctions and what the specific intent that is required, overregulation has real-world consequences for lots of folks. I was going to turn to my previous experience, but go ahead, please.
Well, I'm just
and see what I've. Okay, go ahead.
I'm just curious about how you can separate the monument from the regulation, because it seems to me, and I could be totally wrong here, that some of that.
I'm sure you're partially right, at least.
Yeah, thank you.
No worries.
I'm sure that some of that review involves the very economic impacts that you're talking about. For instance, we want to reduce the size of a particular monument for extraction purposes. Whether it's oil or whether it's coal or whatever it might be. And so I don't see them as really being separate.
I want to thank you for your input on monuments. I'm just going to hold off on discussions of the monuments for the time being. However, for a moment, going back to the successes of regulatory reform at DOI, why have we been successful compared to other agencies? And I think, honestly, a great part of the success is Secretary Zinke. Secretary Zinke assembled a team that was actually brought together a good balance of lawyers, campaign folks, others with previous experience in the Department of Interior, where we all worked together. And a key component of that was bringing in folks who had spent several years before at the Interior Department. And so, instead of trying to run roughshod over our career civil servants. Actually, when you look at all the regulations we're addressing, almost all the actions that occur across the department, it's actually part of an ongoing dialogue between career civil servants and the politicals. And sometimes I'm going to use shorthand here, so when I'm using the term political, that's a non-career appointee that's appointed by the administration to advance the president's vision. I think right now at the Department of the Interior, I could be wrong, I think we have 53 political appointees. Three of them are Senate confirmed, the Secretary, the Deputy Secretary, and the Assistant Secretary for Insular Affairs. We've got about another dozen very important PASs, Presidential Appointment Senate confirmed roles, that have not yet been filled. It's an ongoing challenge to manage a department of 70,000 incredibly talented individuals, about two dozen politicals. But kudos to the secretary for bringing together this team and for those who could actually work well and actually have worked the past 20 years, members of the senior executive service. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question that can be probably answered more generally or more specifically.
I'll go to the more general version.
I represent Montana's Sagegrass Program.
Is there some litigation going on?
There is some litigation going on, and I'm just wondering about.
Notice of intent was published.
Oh my God, you're reading my mind. It's really wonderful. But I think
I'm going to regret opening this to questions.
Generally speaking, I'm curious regarding the tension between the unverification and whether you're going to dismiss all the cases, BLM's cases, in light of the DOI, NOI, and then whether you can comment on the implication for our state, intent to keep the bird from being listed?
First, I want to thank you for your question. and seriously, thank you for all of you for being here and engaged on public issues. I'm sure there are baseball games going on right now. Maybe the Nats and the Cubs getting ready. I don't know who else could be playing this evening. Other things to do. The fact that you care enough about Montana, you care enough about the law, that you would ask these questions and be here today is great. Now, regarding your specific question, I'm not sure if it's because I'm running a fever or because I generally don't comment on ongoing litigation. My friends at DOJ would be a bit chagrined with me, as they are our lead, they do all the litigation for the department. And as as I was on, one additional reason why I was late, as you know, is because DOJ was on the phone on another piece of litigation, not regarding sage grouse, up until about 10 minutes ago. So it'll be interesting to see how the sage grouse issue plays out. I think the Secretary's made very clear his views on this matter. There is ongoing litigation. Not all parties are in alignment, but I think we're moving things in the right direction. Yes, ma'am.
The general.
But I would like to get back to the great civil service.
You know, it's a general list from that question.
Yes, ma'am.
How do you view, or how is the department viewing Endangered Species Act listings as part of the regulatory reform process?
It's an interesting issue. One of the, and I'm going to respond to it in a slightly different way. One of the first decisions I made as acting solicitor was appointing a Section 7 specialist as the new associate solicitor to overseeing the Division of Parks and Wildlife. Career civil servant, it's a career role. But I wanted to make sure that we had a true ESA specialist in that incredibly important role, which does all the legal work for the National Park Service and for the Fish and Wildlife Service. And to me, one of the interesting things about this was once I appointed her, and I started asking her lots of ESA questions. This ESA is incredibly interesting, evolving area of the law. Her response to me was, Dan, I'm a Section 7 specialist. That's a Section 4 question. You need to go to somebody else for Section 4. And then we'd have Section 10 questions. But when we get into ESA, both the law and the regulation, that is complex and evolving. I think it was noted in the Secretary's, some of the Secretary's statements, as well as the Deputy Secretary's, we'll be taking a different approach, a compliant approach, consistent with APA, ESA, all applicable laws, rules, and regulations. When we begin focusing more closely on issues such as critical habitat, which is also the subject of ongoing litigation. But yes, it is something that folds in very deeply with the regulatory reform.
Excuse me, sure. Is that?
He raised his hand first.
Out of hospitality.
I would like to say it's amazing the quality of civil servants at the U.S. Department of the Interior. And we will get to you, and I promise. To me, when I was a junior political, I joined in 2001. I was at a law firm called Aikenville. I had very little knowledge of what actually went on in the Interior Department. I have to tell you, it was one of the best experiences of my life. Best experiences of my life. I was incredibly lucky to work with somebody who was a 30-year veteran of the Senior Executive Service. He was actually the very first class of SESers ever created. Was sort of my career mentor. I had a couple of great political mentors as well. Lynn Scarlett, who's now at the Nature Conservancy. It's an incredible department. And the ability to do good, prevent harm to those to whom we have responsibilities, trust responsibilities, and other responsibilities. It's I don't want to use the term mind-blowing, but it's an incredible place. So, to you.
Out of hospitality, I had an easier question for you about some of your regulatory successes in an area I'm interested in. I know Secretary Zinke, former Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel, Alaska Senator Murkowski, a whole list of others are really pointing towards the Arctic. And on his last visit up there, both Zinke and Murkowski and Dan Sullivan had talked a lot about using reform tools to expedite growth in the Arctic, especially in the shipping industry, and DOI and the Navy own the vast swaths of land up there. I'm just curious about what that vision for success looks like. What kind of tools, in terms of regulatory tools, can enhance growth and development up there, and just what that looks like to you?
Yeah, well, two items. It is intriguing, the issue of the Arctic, because it's not really just a DOI issue. It's not really just for people who live there, who are probably most impacted by whatever decisions get made. But you also look at the interplay of other countries. And it's not just purely environmental, it's natural resource, it's national security. It's a whole variety of things that are going on with the Arctic Council right now. I do apologize for not having the actual copy of my speech here with me, because I did have a list of specific regulatory achievements. But one of them, one of the secretary's, first secretary's orders, was taking a new look at the NPRA, the National Petroleum Reserve of Alaska, and tasking the assistant secretary, acting assistant secretary for land and minerals, to think, how can we approach this more creatively, working closely with the people of Alaska, broadly defined, in a way that will fulfill the president's vision for economic development and with minimal impact to environmental components. But it's something that we're looking at, but when you get into the Arctic, it's intriguing the array of other issues that are raised by them.
I still have my question.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Going back to the Endangered Species Act,
yes,
I'm just curious if you could talk a little bit more about how an economic analysis fits in with what I would consider a more science-driven realm, like Endangered Species.
Yeah, I'm not even sure you should have an economic analysis when we're getting a certain DSA. When we're looking at the specific listings or non-listing, delistings, that's not something that falls within the Regulatory Reform Task Force. That is actually run by the career civil servants within the Fish and Wildlife Service, Gary Fraser, Jim Hurth, and others. Now, the listing packages come up, but it goes to the Assistant Secretary for Fish, Wildlife, and Parks. It's not specifically a part of the Regulatory Task Force. Sure. We'll just make this a full Q&A.
This may not be regulatory reform either, but it made the news when Deputy Secretary Bernhardt.
Is my voice projecting well enough for folks? Okay. I see some folks falling asleep in the back. Just might be my non-exciting demeanor.
Made the news when Deputy Secretary Bernhardt announced that environmental impact statements should be quicker and shorter. Given
it was 1 year, and then for standard projects, and there are specific definitions in that secretary's order, maximum page limit of 150, up to 300 pages for unusually complex projects. Anything going beyond those exceptions require a written statement, and a written approval by the acting assistant secretary.
Yeah, both quicker and shorter than the conventions have been in recent years. Given the case law, are you concerned the courts won't go along with the ASs like that?
Deputy Secretary Bernhardt is an incredibly good person, and he's very focused on NEPA and NEPA reform. And if anybody can make it happen in a way consistent with case law, consistent with what's going on in different circuits, I'm confident the Deputy Secretary. And one of the items we've noticed when this administration arrived, there were a lot of complaints about it. And what was going on with the NEPA regs? Actually, when you look at it, it's not the case law per se, it's not the regs, it's really just lack of effective management with different firms and with contractors. I think that's something the Deputy Secretary is really going to be focusing folks on. Within the solicitor's office, the counselor to the solicitor, Ann Navarro, is coordinating an entire NEPA reform project. She joined us from DOJ, and after DOJ, the Army Corps of Engineers. Incredibly talented attorney, very focused on NEPA reform, and working closely with the senior leadership team. Another example of integrating the best of the career civil servants in the senior leadership. Okay, now I can actually remember where I was in my comments. When we came aboard, obviously, President Trump issued a regulatory reform executive order, and then soon thereafter, another executive order focused on energy and economic development. The secretary didn't join until early March of this year, and quickly started rolling out the secretary's orders, onshore energy development, offshore energy development, ending the, what some call, the war on coal. Others is just a coal moratorium. In one secretary's order, I think we had 6 or 7 specific actions that could have fit into 7 separate orders. That addressed a new look at compensatory mitigation, a new look at what had been done in previous years regarding climate change in a compliant manner. Also looked at taking a fresh look at hydraulic fracking, venting and flaring, and oil and gas development on or adjacent to national parks and the Fish and Wildlife Service. So secretary issues an order. What happens next? It's just a secretary's order. And the next thing, organizing the different bureaus, put a fresh set of eyes on this, take comments, and begin the process, should we determine from a policy perspective, not reaching any predetermined conclusions, to actually begin working with OIR on rescinding certain rules and issuing other new rules. Everything we do, though, for this sort of process, to go back to the question about over-regulation, worker welfare, over-prosecution, these are issues that actually were of great concern to the Obama administration as well. The issue of an overarching regulatory state cuts across partisan boundaries. And so, whether we're focused on streamlining NEPA, whether we're focused on protecting individual rights, property rights, and doing things that are generally for the benefit of what we call regular, hardworking Americans, who don't necessarily have lawyers on K Street, who can't retain firms like Akin Gump or Venable or others to lobby on their behalf. That's part of the goal behind shrinking the administrative state and actually stimulating the economy. Any questions on that? Okay. Jerry, do you have a question? No. Another component of this, I was going to turn to Indian country, but I'll leave that.
It just, all the regulatory actions that you've taken, though, would seem to be ones that benefit exactly who you're talking about. That, like, if you think
intriguing, isn't it?
If you think of public choice theory that you invoke, right, public choice theory would predict that concentrated business interests would be favored, and that the diffuse public interest would not.
And it's classic public choice theory.
Right, exactly.
You don't have to believe in bootleggers and Baptists.
If you look at Dundee and Flaring and Hybrid and the cracking rule, the actions that you've taken are supported by the concentrated business interests and opposed, the primary opposition is from diffuse
public interest. Yeah, it is. I mean, that's the intriguing thing about regulation. That's really where the rubber hits the road. You've got nonstop conflict of interests and different visions of how the economy should operate. Part of this, though, when you look at regulations, I don't want to comment on ongoing litigation. Some regulations that might be issued, you can make the argument the department didn't have the authority to issue in the first place. And so the question is, when we look constitutionally or legally, what are the actual authorities? Was the venting and flaring regulation really designed to minimize waste, or was that around the corner sort of way to regulate air? Hydraulic fracking on public lands, is that within DOI's responsibilities? And so this is why these are these ongoing sort of debates. But when you get to public interest, but
you change your justification.
Oh, no.
It started out as you offered the regulatory issues as an example of counteracting concentrated interests, and now when I've asked you about that, you've switched to a legal justification.
Oh, no, I would hate to say it's purely one or the other, because when you get to these regulatory decisions, it's a wide confluence of issues that we get in politics, academic debate, and we're actually having to make some tough decisions. But there is no doubt, one thing the president campaigned on was getting the economy going again. And he views energy development here in the United States as a positive good. So do I.
The answer to the question is, how are you, if the regulatory reform initiatives that you cited are the two of the ones on your maybe list of four, are fracking rule and the venting and flaring rule, and the justification that you offered for them was concentrated business interests, how does one support the other? And you cited other justifications.
Let's go to concentrated business interests, if that's what you'd like to focus on.
No, but that's what you focus on.
How would you?
I'm just saying, like, you offered a justification for regulatory reform, and it was counteracting concentrated business interests. And when I asked you how that supported the actual regulatory reform that you've taken, you switched to other justifications. I'm just asking you to go back
and let me go back to
justification that you offered to support the actions that you did.
It's a very good question. So let me step back, and perhaps I miscommunicated. Because it's often not what people say, it's what people hear. So you have to be very careful in the communications. There's no sole one reason
If you want to say battling corporate welfare or battling cronyism is an important reason to address the overreach of the regulatory state. Whereas this gentleman mentioned in the back, over-criminalization, tremendous prosecutorial discretion. There are many factors that go into all these decisions. But one, I think President Trump has been 10,000% clear on, is the importance of energy development domestically. There's no way around that. Something I fully support as well. That doesn't mean other factors don't play into it. But what we do believe, and again, maybe many others here don't believe, we view energy development in the United States as a net good. It can be done compliantly. And when you compare it to the secretary does, the energy development done in other countries, not all other countries, but in certain other countries, where there are very few environmental protections, we think environmental protection done here compliantly using best practices is all in all a net good. And that's leaving aside the creation of jobs for middle class Americans. But that's not a perfect answer, but I'm trying to give more context. Yes.
Thanks. Do you mind touching on your relationship with privacy?
Oh, my apologies, I am taking too much time here. It's an incredibly important issue. It's incredibly important, the relationship, sovereign relationship between the U.S. Department of the Interior and the tribes. One that you can say has arguably been mismanaged since March 3rd, 1849, since the creation of the U.S. Department of the Interior. I'm not saying that is the case, but from my time, from 01 to 09, and going through different types of litigation, what we're dealing with now, it requires ongoing attention. And so much of this is, frankly, humility on the part of the department, not just in our relations with Indian country, but frankly with the broad. You go first. Sorry.
Well, what do you tell tribes when President Trump declares Columbus Day and doesn't even recognize Indigenous people?
Yeah, actually, I don't control the comm shop at the White House. That's not within the purview of the regulatory task force. I will say, because it's a good question. And I didn't read the statement, so I believe you're accurately summarizing it. I believe there was another statement that came out recently the White House was working on, specifically on the importance of Native American communities and on the historic relationship between the U.S. government, sovereign tribes, and individual Indians. On the issue of Columbus, I know it's an incredibly controversial issue, but I don't know what went into that press release. But you're right, this gets to the point, which I think you're making. It's often not what you say, it's what other people. And everybody brings their own experiences, what people are saying or are not saying. Does that get you closer? Feel free to follow up.
I was last year. I just think tribes are really, you know, Secretary did say how important the trust relationship was when he got confirmed, but it took a long time to hire Mr. And I just wanted to know what the regulatory reform, what your guys' mission was regarding your relationship.
I wasn't meaning to smile or laugh when you said that about the length of time to hire John Tsuda. All I can say is what a great day it was for us when John Tsuda came into the department. It was also a great day when Gavin Clarkson, I guess, you're talking about the incredibly lengthy time it takes to clear through PPO. So it's not within the secretary's discretion, usually, in any administration. Political appointees have to clear through something called PPO. And that's an ongoing process, I think, one the secretary has voiced incredible frustration with on more than one occasion. However, I think I can say we've got John Tsuda, we've got Gavin Clarkson, and you know, fingers crossed for some good news in the very near future. You, yes.
Yeah. So, in regards to respecting the tribes and treaties, I think it's a little concerning that you're talking about reforming NEPA.
Administratively, not legislatively, change the law.
Right. I think, like, where do you plan to go with your NEPA reform? Are you, in regards to tribes, are you going to increase engagement during the scoping period, which we've seen is a problem with the Dakota Access Pipeline? Are you going to increase engagement?
Dakota Access, that's another one I think I've heard of. On NEPA reform, it's an incredibly important issue. Have you read the Secretary's order on NEPA? I will email it to you. Okay. And I will email you the contact information for Ann Navarro, who's running the Solicitor's Task Force on NEPA reform. It's an incredibly important issue. I would be misleading you if I gave you a definitive answer one way or the other, because the Secretary's order was just released, what, 3 weeks ago? And so, but the Solicitor's Task Force met today. I was on an airplane, couldn't be there. But if you're interested in the topic, we'll make sure you're connected with the right people. And I'll get you a copy of the Secretary's order. Is that helpful?
Yeah, thank you.
Dan, you've been very generous to let us pepper you with questions. Do you want to take a few minutes to wrap things up and express the things you want to say when you
hear? Oh, at this point, let's not worry about it. Okay,
so
we can take a couple more. I do want to know what an incredible person Secretary Zinke is. Just a genuinely incredible person. Not just as a war hero, not just as a leader, but really as a person of integrity who does things, everything the right way. Definitely not a classic politician, but to me that's been one of the, I've now served under three separate cabinet secretaries, and he is just an incredibly, incredibly good person. Tries to do everything the right way. I'll leave it at that unless there are other questions. Oh, I see. Yeah, sure. Go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
So
yes, sir.
I have two quick questions. One is, I'm
gentleman behind
the administration's position.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Yeah. I have two quick questions. One is related to how you define or how the administration defines overregulation. It appears that you define it in terms of quantitative assessment. In other words, there's simply too many regulations. And in that regard, I'd like to know what your opinion is with regards to the OPSMAC budget congressional reports, which have consistently reported since 1997 that the benefits outweigh the cost of regulations, hands down.
Don't get me started on OMB.
So that's my first question. So what weight do you put in OMB reports?
I have tremendous respect for OMB. Wonderful people. I have good friends who work at OMB. They issue the actual impact of one individual reg and what the true cost benefit is on an aggregate. And you'll see some reports say it's $2.3 trillion burden on the economy every year. And you look at those numbers by certain sort of think tanks, and the numbers don't really seem to add up. There's not a lot of rigor with some of the analysis. It is an ongoing debate, though. And part of it, too, is what some call the ossification of the regulatory system, where it's just one regulation after another, after another, after another. And the burden that puts, not just on businesses, tribes, individual Americans, but it's sort of the aggregate. And then a large part of this should be done legislatively instead of shifting things over to the administrative state. What was your second question?
So. And just a brief follow-up to that, do you disagree, however, with their numbers that they're, in 2015, for example, when it comes to quantitative or qualitative assessment of regulations, that there were only 30 major regulations issued across all executive agencies in 2015, and that's defined by the Congressional Review Act as a major regulation having an economic impact?
Oh, yeah, it's a quantitative measurement for what's a major reg. So I don't disagree with that number. If you're asking all the OMB reports back to 1996, I confess I haven't read them all. But I will give you my card, and then we can continue the debate going on, because it is an incredibly important issue. I'm sorry, you had a question back there. Somebody else? Oh, yes.
You referenced the goal of the department, and I think there was some publicity about from Secretary Zinke about moving offices to the West, or at least moving
the
personnel to the West.
Yes.
And Is there actually a task force looking at that, or, and why not? We're west, I mean, I don't know what the percentage is. 90% of the lands are in the west. Why don't we have the regulators out west? Is this just more political talk?
How many people like BLM and BIA moved out west to Missoula? Move the headquarters here.
That's what I'm getting. That's exactly what I'm getting at, all the economic development from Missoula.
That's an incredibly good idea, sir. And yes, there is a team working on that. With OMB, I will say.
Well, mention Missoula as a location.
Missoula is never far from the thoughts of the Department of the Interior.
Just a quick point, aren't regulations...
And the greater state of Montana as a whole.
Aren't regulations done by teams in the Department of the Interior? So you do have field staff working on regulation, and you also have DC staff. So aren't there already...
It varies from reg to reg, frankly. For the rewrite of some major regs, we assemble teams and war rooms with very specific timelines. Sometimes we pull in folks from the regional solicitor's office out of Denver, the Rocky Mountain regional solicitor, Matt McCallum, phenomenal lawyer. Other times, if it's something that might impact Alaska, NPRA, we'll bring in somebody from Joe Darnell's team, regional solicitor for Alaska. So it's always a balance. But it's a good question. You always want to make sure that you're bringing in as much experience from the field as you can. I'll give one small example, I guess, which is the M opinion on railroad rights of way, which was one that a lot of debate internally within the solicitor's office. It was withdrawing a previous M opinion. Part of the process, because in theory, I could write a 2-page M opinion and issue it, and there you have it. That wouldn't create much value unless you have buy-in from the career civil servants, often the ones who wrote the previous iteration. A large part of this is dialogue to get to the right place. In this case, it was mainly folks in DC. I didn't reach out too much to folks in the field. Then it's dialogue with DOJ, because DOJ might have litigation positions. They might want language tweaked in a certain way as well. So an advantage of living in our era, I can pick up the phone and call the regional solicitor in Denver. I can call fantastic people in Montana and get their feedback. But these are all ongoing processes, whether it's specific notice and comment, or whether it's M opinions. And we did railroad rights of way. There might be another 2 or 3 new M opinions in the next couple of weeks. I'm sorry, somebody else had a question in the back. As long as it's not about Indian gaming.
I'm also curious on your opinion with regards to regulation advice economics I used to be, I spent the last 2 years as a coal attorney, but I am curious, however, the administration's perspective on how decreasing regulations is going to bring back economic development for oil and gas when it seems fairly clear. Mm-hmm. That really the downturn in coal and gas is related to economics and not particular cheaper natural gas.
Yeah, it isn't hydraulic fracking and the revolution. Yeah, that is intriguing. To go back to your first point, it's not simply getting rid of regulations, because there are thousands of regulations you could get rid of that would have no economic impact, would actually have negative impact, would not create value. The goal is to do this carefully and systematically, making sure you have buy-in from the best lawyers, the best economists, and that it's a debate. To go back to one of what was in the original version of my comments before we got into I emphasize the integrity of the secretary, and that's so important. But other components to this, which I think I mentioned before, humility, not assuming that a bunch of politicals who show up on January 20th know everything about the Interior Department. You've got people who've worked 20, 30, 40 years in the department, have tremendous subject matter expertise. You have folks in the field, in stakeholder groups. Their knowledge of sage grouse might actually surpass that of the Fish and Wildlife Service. Don't tell people in the Fish and Wildlife Service that. The part of it is just humility, integrity, sharing knowledge, and treating people with respect. So whether it's issuing a new rule,
a new M opinion, or simply managing your office. Those are just incredibly important. Anything else?
Thank you all.
An engaged and informed audience. That was an awesome conversation. Thank you, Daniel, for being willing to do that with us.
I love Montana.
This talk and the cocktail reception after has been generously sponsored by Cloud Peak Energy, and I have to make sure I